Okay, so we're here at Cal IT2, and we're going to be speaking with Dan Stokols from the School of Social Ecology, who's been somebody who we've worked with, several of us have worked with recently, and who I think has some really interesting perspectives on the topic. So I'm here with Dan Stokols, who's a professor here at UCI. And Dan is in the Department of Social Ecology here, and we're interested in getting his opinion on some of the ideas from the class. And so thank you very much for coming and allowing yourself to be interviewed by us. The first thing I wanted to ask you about, the topics of our course focus on how do you satisfy basic human needs in a sustainable way. And one major aspect that we're talking about is infrastructure. And infrastructures serve to address human needs in a variety of ways. I was wondering, from your point of view, could you tell us what infrastructure is and how it relates to these topics?
Well, to my mind, infrastructure are really the basic resources that are needed to support and sustain a system. Could be a physical system, could be a biological system, technological system, but these resources could be organized into different categories, ranging from social kinds of resources to physical material resources to cyber kinds of resources, biological, as in the case of ecosystem services. So I think an important aspect of sustainability is the extent to which these various resources are interfaced well, and the flows among those different kinds of resources. And to the extent that those are functioning well, the system tends to be more sustainable.
Hmm. That's really interesting. So I was also wondering, so you come from the Department of Social Ecology.
It's a School of Social Ecology.
School of Social Ecology.
Which has three departments.
Okay.
So I'm in the Psych and Social Behavior Department,
okay,
and the Planning, Policy, and Design Department. And
okay.
The third is Criminology Law and Society.
Okay, thanks. So what are some challenges from the point of view of the disciplines that you've worked with? What are some of the challenges of sustainability as you see it?
Well, I think a key challenge is that there are so many different and competing conceptions of sustainability. So a challenge is to get enough of the interested players or stakeholders on the same page as to what's meant by sustainability. Some definitions of sustainability include the notion of preserving for future generations sufficient levels of resources that they're able to thrive. Other notions of sustainability incorporate much more heavily notions of equity, justice, protecting vulnerable groups, in other words, what's sustained for whom, mm-hmm, in society among varying groups. And so one can take a kind of economic frame and apply it to sustainability. One can look at it from a kind of philosophical moral point of view. And so a social ecological perspective implies an integration across several different of those perspectives, kind of an inter or transdisciplinary amalgamation or integration of points of view about sustainability that many folks can agree on. And I think the challenge is getting enough of the interested stakeholders in the system to agree on what are the key features or goals of sustainability.
Hmm.
For example, whether equity and justice have to be traded off or should be traded off for some economic gains in the system, in the society, whether those three goals of people, planet, profits can be integrated effectively so that they're all accommodated in a kind of equitable fashion.
Hmm. I'm interested to hear you mention equity because we recently applied for an NSF CyberSeas grant, and in NSF's definition of sustainability, sort of for the first time that I had seen it coming out of the NSF, they used equitable, mm-hmm, as one of their words. And so I was glad to see that showing up in NSF's definition of sustainability. So.
Well, I think it's really important because I think so many of the threats to the world's future welfare can be rooted in the stark polarization that we're seeing throughout the world, whether that be along political lines, religious lines, economic lines. And so there are often arguments and disagreements about what's equitable for whom and, mm-hmm, whose interests are being optimized for a future world.
Right. So one other main topic in our course is information technology.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering if you had any thoughts on how information technology might be able to be brought to bear on some of these issues.
I think information technology is vitally important in promoting sustainability goals. And I think there are a variety of ways in which information technology systems can contribute to that effort. So one area is in terms of providing feedback about what their behaviors are and what their resource consumption is like on a day-to-day basis. Studies show that the more people know what they're doing and have that kind of feedback, the more they can align their behavior with particular goals that might be closely related to sustainability. So there's a kind of feedback function that information technology can provide. There's a kind of visioning function where technological systems can portray images of the future that people that aren't salient to people in the present, but when they see these images of what a heated up planet might look like 50 to 100 years down the road, it can engage their behavior and their concern in a much more direct way. So there are efforts underway to use appeals to people's emotions. Certain artists, environmental artists, use very stark images of the future or the present to get people focused on the importance of sustainability and to engage their behavior in line with those goals. So I think there's a feedback function, there's a visioning function. Information technology systems can also be very important in monitoring environmental conditions to see exactly how sea rise is shifting from year to year, for example, or the composition of air. So in so many ways that environmental monitoring helps inform our images of the future and what we want to do about them. I think also information technology can be used for greater communication and collaboration among people in a society to enable them to coordinate more effectively in terms of shared goals. And nowadays, with the growing alarm and concern about planetary warming, there's more and more need for that kind of coordination and communication among people in different parts of the world. So I think there are a lot of ways in which information technology is vital.
Great. And I want to tie into, you mentioned the visioning and artists getting people engaged. I feel like some of that, there's sort of a flip side of that, which is marketing and convincing people to do things against their best interests. So I was wondering if you could comment on some of the ethical considerations of trying to convince people or use psychology to cause people to behave in environmentally sensitive ways.
Yeah. Well, there certainly is a very well-developed science of persuasion in the field of social psychology, where there are certain principles that can be applied to influence and change people's behavior. I think the kinds of functions I was mentioning that information technology can be used for, such as feedback and visioning, to me don't pose as stark ethical concerns as, let's say, applying information technology to reinforce or shape particular behaviors in a given direction. So giving people feedback about what's going on in the world, how the environment is actually changing objectively, what different scenarios of the future might look like, I think is informative, and it's not unduly focused on trying to manipulate behavior. On the other hand, you could make the case that some of these persuasive technologies that are being used to shape behavior in a more sustainable way aren't ethical because the individuals that are exposed to them don't know that they're being exposed. And there I think we get into a very complex and philosophical set of trade-offs between the dire ramifications of global warming, which more and more data suggests are very, very serious and crucial. And if we don't do something about them, that's a moral issue in terms of letting the planet go off kilter and become another Venus, for example, where we heat up beyond the point where life can sustain here. So in some cases, those kinds of ethical goals have to be traded off, I would say. It's not to say we should plunge willy-nilly into trying to shape everyone's behavior to do certain things in their home or on the road, but I think there is a case that could be made for some of that happening in light of the evidence that's piling up about the fairly dire challenges we face in the realm of environmental change. What can we do to offset the consequences of those? Right. And that becomes a moral issue or choice in its own right.
Yeah. And I guess people's behaviors are being shaped all the time by lots of different forces. And so so having some that are representing sustainable issues rather than just corporate issues or or other perspectives might have some place in it.
Yeah, and I think there's an issue to some extent of informed consent, where to the extent that people know that these systems are in place and they concur with them and they're aligned with societal goals, and people are more on the same page, then the ethical concern tends to diminish some.
I see.
If they're just being applied in a way that isn't transparent and is manipulative without people knowing that it's there, or without choosing that it be there. In their home, for example, somebody can invest in a feedback system so that they can monitor their behavior in the home in terms of energy consumption, et cetera. So it becomes a personal or a family choice. But we are probably moving to the point where these reinforcement systems and persuasive technologies are going to be rather pervasive in society. And maybe not everybody is going to have input as to whether those be implemented or not.
Well, great. Well, thank you very much, Dan, for taking the time to be interviewed for our class.
Sounds like a great class.
It's been really great. Thanks so much.
What's your favorite app on your phone?
My favorite app? That's a good question. I've been using Twitter a fair amount, more than I ever thought I would.
What's surprising about Twitter for you?
I always thought it was dumb, you know, that people would be wasting time on all these tweets. But then I realized that it's an amazing networking and information sharing platform, especially when people incorporate URLs in their tweets. So I found it to be pretty interesting that way in terms of broadening the kinds of materials and sources that I read. I try to regulate how much time I spend on it because I've got enough email to deal with, certainly. And I use Facebook some, but I've been using Twitter a little bit more, partly because I saw my son, who's a journalist, use it in a very kind of pervasive way, you know, to break stories, follow leads, sources, that kind of thing. So I got curious about it and started using it more.
All right. Cool. What'd you have for lunch?
I had some lox, a banana, and iced mocha. Yeah, that wasn't bad.
All right, great. What's your banana story?
Okay, so hearing that Dan had a banana for lunch, I'm reminded of when I was in grad school, I had a guy named Richard Rangham on my dissertation committee. And he was the world expert in aggression and chimpanzees. And so he studied apes, effectively. And so in the grad school I went to, it was known that when you were doing your qualifying exams as part of your PhD, you should call all of the people who were going to be there and make sure there was food that they would like. And so I called up my advisor, and he wanted Diet Coke, and I called up somebody else, and they wanted pastries. And so I called up Richard Rangham's assistant. This is the assistant to the guy who's like the world expert in chimpanzees. And said, well, what do you think he'd like? And she's like, oh, he likes bananas. And I was like, oh, of course he does. So anyway, that's my banana story.
Did you have bananas at your dissertation?
Oh, I did.
Did it go well?
It passed.
Yeah, there you go. What app are you most excited about today, in the now?
Recently, I've been excited about the Zillow app because as you can drive around, you can find out how much all the properties cost.
Property stalking.
Yeah. You can like drive by your neighbors and like figure out how much the house costs and stuff.
Right.
Doesn't work in University Hills, though, because everything's off the books.
Right.